Yo, what's going on, everybody? You out here in Brooklyn, New York, you know what I'm saying? This is Lord Nez for Neztalgic, you know, representing that old school classic feel. Nothing but half moon fade type shit, feel of the wars and all that, you feel me? But I got a special surprise for y'all. I got someone very, very special, and you know what I mean? This is like my sister, and I think you guys need to know about her. I'm going to introduce her, but she's going to introduce herself. This is April Walker from Walkerwear, and you know, she's just a pioneer in the hip-hop culture, and you know, we're going to honor her today, and we're going to get to know the people who don't know, they're going to get to know her, and the people who do know, we're going to refresh y'all, and you know, she has some things in the works as well, so stay tuned, man. Last time I've been here, you had your first photo shoot, and I was honored to be a part of it. Give thanks, and from that transition, I've seen a lot happen, but I always knew personally, I've been a fan. This is what's so crazy, like, you're my big sis, but ever since I was young, you know what I mean, I always, hip-hop was my life, so I used to watch video music box, shout out to Uncle Ralph, and in a lot of the videos, I used to see some of the rappers with some certain garments, and I want to put the viewers on, like, you may know, or you may not know, but everybody, if you're a hip-hop head, you've seen Walker with. Well, you've seen it, but you might not know, and some people know. So, you know, you had artists like Tupac Shakur, Biggie Smalls, R.I.P., Jam Master Jay, Onyx. You know, I was coming up in that era, and I used to see these brothers wearing fly garments. They had like an ill rug on it, sweatsuits, vest jean suits, and things like that. And I was like, what is this? Who is it? And one, you know, LL Cool J, I'm from Howard. So he had a video called Pink Cookies, you know what I'm saying? She's in it, you in it, I seen you on Farmers. And you know, he had the outfit on, the black jean, I think it was a vest outfit. And that was around 92, and that's when I got familiar with Walkerwear as a youngster, you know, but I was too young, you know what I mean, to actually get it and purchase it. So, but ever since I was young, I was intrigued by it. So I'm sure.
How young were you then?
I was born 81, so I maybe
81?
I was maybe like 13, 12.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So I was wearing, you know, we had the cross colors, the canals and things, but the juniors editions wasn't really.
Right.
We always had fly sneakers, but we couldn't really get the garments, right, especially custom. So, you know what I mean? I always admired it. So let's fast forward it. You know, we know people, our family are mutual. So when I met you for the first time through my godfather, I was like,
right,
April Walker, right. Oh my gosh, like, it's an honor to meet you. So I just feel it's important, you know, shout out to FUBU, shout out to Carl Canal, because FUBU's from my hood, you know what I mean? Shout out to Keith and Damon and all of them. But I think it's important that people actually know your contributions to the culture and what you've done and why you're so important to like, the urban culture, because, you know what I mean? I feel a lot of these artists that these people look up, like Biggie, R.I.P., and Tupac, you know, you were styling them and helping them with their image that people are emulating now. So I just want people to know your starting, you know what I'm saying, your background a little bit. Like, you know, you from Brooklyn. I know you were doing it. I seen a picture of you. I don't know these guys' names, but they were some OGs from Brooklyn, and they were in bow ties and tuxedos, and you styled them. I'm like, wow. Like,
right.
So I know even besides the music, you style and help the community of Brooklyn. So I want people, you know, just give everybody a brief history, you know.
A Walkerwear?
Yeah, Walkerwear and
me?
Just you, because you've always been in design.
So, like you said, I'm Brooklyn. I'm Brooklyn, yeah. People don't know I was born in LA.
Really? See, I didn't even know
that. Just learned that, right? But I came here, my father, I'm definitely the product of a jazz baby. And so,
me too.
Right, so
that's why we relate. I got a song too on my new album called Magic the Jazz Baby, so it speaks for us. I'm trying to get Gary on.
And so that's how we came together.
Yeah, shout out to Gary Bartz. And my mom's and my godfather, Gary Bartz, and her father, they all know each other through the jazz musicians and the community type. So, you know, we're the product of that.
Yeah, so from that, we moved around a lot. So I was born in LA. My sister T, the middle sister, she was born in Roxbury, Mass. And Jackie was born in Harlem Hospital. So that's how we ended up here. But we came here when I was still like a few years old. So, and we lived in the South Bronx first.
Then oh, so that was down in the Bronx.
Down there, the Village for a little bit, and then we ended up here real early though. So Brooklyn, I've been here all my life pretty much. I grew up in Bed-Stuy, Madison, between those two months, next to the old boys' house.
Yeah.
And then from there we came here. So I've been here for a long time, you know.
So it's basically your blood. So basically, I'm gonna ask you this later how you feel about this new Brooklyn, but just from the like Tomahawk days and like the God body.
And I remember when they opened up Marcy Pool when we first started going there. That's how long I've been in Brooklyn. So I've seen it go through a lot of changes, but that's how, you know, I grew up in Brooklyn and I went to Brooklyn Tech and Bishop Laughlin and always knew I think because my father was in the music business, I think all of us were creative in our own right, me and my sister. And then I think, I can't sing, so I wasn't doing that. You know?
Right. like, I'm not going to.
So, I can't rap, so, you know, no, but I always,
You always like dressing up in the store.
Since I was in high school, like I was. Like sneaking out my mom's clothes and all of that. You know, like I was always that. And so, I mean, to the point where I would get in trouble for clothes. So, I think that I had one job and it was at American Express. And I remember looking around and it was a girl I looked up to that was right next to me. And she was like, one day it was like boom, it hit me. She was like telling me about everybody that worked there. She was like, he's been here 6 years, he's been here 15 years. Da-da-da-da. See, if you do the right thing, you can move up, you can be a manager. And I was like, damn, it hit me like, I'm sure these people didn't think they were going to be here forever.
Temporary type.
And I was like, I'm not doing that.
I'm out.
So I figured out real quick. And the other thing was I hung out a lot. So I was a party girl, so I used to go to Apollo Theater amateur night back in the day.
So what year, give the viewers like what era, like what year you think that
was?
This is
early 80s, so I would go there and then
we'd go
ahead.
So this is in the prime where like the city was
like. This is the Reaganomics, the crack baby era, like all of that.
The hip hop.
It was a period when like when you think about the streets, like I look at what's going on now and the synergy is so much the same and different but the same. Like. The way you see skateboarders, that's not new. Like, that was happening in 1990, 1988. It was happening, like, the surfboard slash skateboard slash hip-hop, that all gelled together. That's why you had t-shirt lines like No Fear.
Back I remember in the day, those. I had no a sticker fear. Of No Fear.
You know, that was
Zoo
West
York
Coast
and all that.
For all of that. Like, you see it now, Zoomies and Zoo York and all of that. But that's just bringing the culture together, and the culture organically was coming together because it was very about anti-establishment and making a way out of no way, or
it was more rebellious
attitude, right? Of like kind of like because people don't understand you, and so you were expressing yourself, and skate culture was expressing themselves, surfers were expressing themselves, graffiti artists were expressing themselves, and hip-hop heads, you know,
one common denominator.
We were all expressing ourselves, and hip-hop was that glue, you know, so that's how it came together, like, and when I look at videos today and see a lot of the artists, they, like, emulating stuff in the 80s, still, you know, so it's deep to me to see that, because that's what I grew up in, and I was a part of that, so, like, I used to hang in Dapper Dan's spot and watch, you know, like,
This is history, like, but I always wanted a Dapper Dan outfit, you know what I mean? I emulated to that, and to the day you see the MCM bags and they're trying to, you know what I mean?
Yeah, he was part of that inspiration for me. I think that, you know, I think I saw his hustle and what he was doing. I know that I loved clothes. I knew that I wasn't going to work for somebody.
So was he like an inspiration to you? Like, say like, I'm an MC, so I see like Nas as an inspiration for me. So that was same. Comparison.
Definitely. You know, Dapper Dan. You know, those are the people that I kind of related to and said, you know what, I could do this. Mm-hmm. And what prompted me to start my first store in Brooklyn, which was a custom shop that made anything. It was called Fashion and Effect. And it was right in Clinton Hill and it was on Green between Cambridge and Grand. And it was
How long was that open for?
That was open for 3-4 years, and the 80s.
So you was just serving like the local, everybody that wanted to get fly, they would just come see you.
Yep. Anybody that wanted to be fly, want something different for Easter, for whatever.
Right. You know, you got the Easter outfit. Exactly. Everybody want to get fresh.
For the balls. You said you saw like street dudes.
Yeah, I saw some.
I did a lot.
I don't want to say no names. Yeah, I know who they are, but yes.
Street cats that did their thing.
Could you tell them something too? Like, you come from an era where it was like real all around the board. Like, how was it like, you know, being a woman and coming up and surviving? Like, I'm sure you've seen so many brothers and sisters that didn't make it. And for you to still be here and be healthy and alive and prosperous, like, I know that's a blessing in itself.
Yeah, thankful to God, because, like, put it like this, I come from that period and I have more friends that didn't make it than did living right now. So
I gotta
thank your days just to be waking up in the morning.
I'm trying to tell these youngsters too, especially in the hip hop, like they emulate and they want to be a certain way. But you guys come from an era where y'all were born and raised a certain way, and y'all trying to escape it. So it's like y'all wasn't trying to glorify being tough or poor or being where you came from. That's just what you guys were.
A lot of it was a survival thing. Mm. A lot of it was, you know, not getting into conspiracy theories, but I do believe that the system is built a certain way. Mm-hmm. And I think that they push those things on us. And so the streets were, that's what was happening in the streets. Mm-hmm. And when you don't have a lot of things in the hood to occupy your time, it's like that becomes your game. You know what I mean? So we fell right into that system. And it's a revolving system that happens. And it's revolving now. It's just happening with different things. Pills.
Yeah.
With this and that. With prescription pills. And all the kind of crap that they feed in us that we keep being a slave to. You know, it's definitely a slavery mentality that's being fed to us.
I agree. I think
and it's never going to stop unless we stop it. And that's where we have to come out. And I'm only speaking this from being one of them.
Right.
So I'm not being judgmental right now. I have no judgment.
Speaking from
experience of being in the role and then being outside of it through my own personal growth. And a lot of that growth comes from watching my friends get killed or doing life. You know what I mean? I just am like, you know, we have to break that cycle, because to me the biggest treasures we have are in the graves right now. We gotta stop that from happening.
Rest in peace, J. Master. That's one of them. I mean, we gonna get into that too, because I know he's, you know, a big part of your life as far as, you know, just a friend. You know, and I can feel it, so we'll get into that later. But I just wanted you guys to share that, because, you know, this sister's real all around the board, and she comes from a real era that a lot of kids now, man, you guys wouldn't even probably last a week. Be honest, and I'm not even trying to brag or nothing, but you know what I'm saying, it's just what it is, man. And it's a blessing that she's still here, you can talk about it, and it's still prospering. You know what I mean? So it's a respect. So let's get into from when you had the store, things like that. How did you start meeting like you know, recording artists and rappers and DJs, people in the music? How did you start establish relationships, and how did those relationships help your brand and build, walk away?
It's so funny you just said something. You said establish relationships. So the way we established relationships then was totally different than the social media.
That's what I was saying. Like, we got Twitter, Facebook, Instagram.
We actually had to do this.
We had to meet each other.
You know what I mean? Right. Look in each other's eyes.
Right.
Which now, you know, you got all these, to me, split personalities online, you know, people that are totally making false identities. Some people that, you know, never would say things face to face that say things real
crazy
on social media. So it's funny watching that dynamic, but I digress. We didn't have that, so it was all about us. So, like, meeting up, it was so organic, and that's what was cool about it. And I think that's what created community then, right?
That's what I was
about to
say.
Because we were all growing
up
in hip-hop,
right.
So we embraced each other and had general love for each other, because it wasn't like a disconnect where we could just do this all day.
Right.
We had to meet up And so that's a bond that you create with each other. It creates memories, it creates experiences.
It creates a lot of
things.
It's funny that you said that, because I was watching a documentary with Nelson Jordan, and he was talking about, like, it was the era of Fort Greene, mm-hmm. where, like, a lot of actors, they all lived, like, Wesley Snipes and a few others. They all lived in, Rosie Perez, they all lived in the same neighborhood at the same time.
Like, they all lived here at the same time.
Right. So it's like, they didn't know they were going to be who they were, but they was a community, and they all wound up doing
all
work.
Artistic, doing nothing.
And the work wound up being what it is now, and historically, and I feel it's, you've done the same thing with hip hop, like just organically.
You didn't know what you were doing.
Right, you didn't know what you were doing, like,
because you loved it. You know?
Now it's, I think it's more control. Like people, they get into to like, I want to do this, I want to do that. I guess you had ambitions, but I know it was more for the love, and y'all just.
I was definitely very driven. So you know, I think two things. Well, I was driven. Two things drove me to be honest: passion. Like I generally loved what I. Right. I love what I
do. So tell the viewers
that's
the
first
thing.
And then I was definitely ambitious where I wanted to make money. I'm not going to lie. You know,
the hustle
mm-hmm. was naturally in me. So I think, but I think that if you find your passion, the hustle comes because you're always going to go hard for what you love. That just comes. And then you will, like this is experience showing me now. You don't have to chase the money because the money will come to you because you're doing what you're supposed to do. Like, I think there is something in divinity and God placing a seed in each of us for us to do something great. And we all have our own. We have something. You have something nobody else could do in life. You were put here to do what you're supposed to be doing. And you and God only know what that is. You know what I mean? And it's up to you to believe in that, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if you believe in that, then God got you. You're going to do what you're supposed to do, and you'll always be all right. You know?
It's like I'm interviewing you, but it's like you're dropping so many jewels on me because these are like what I think about all the time. You're just giving me confirmation.
And you just have to believe in yourself. And I think that's where it gets tough for most of us because we got to pay
discouraging.
Our bills.
Yeah,
you know, we got to live out. We don't know what the timing is like, right? It's never our time. It's God's time.
Mm-hmm.
All of those things. But I do believe that with all of my heart. Like, when I look back on things, the worst things we thought we would never get through, we got through, right? We're still standing.
Still
standing.
And
it's good.
That's
real.
Like, I didn't look at it like that.
But bottom line, like how I got into fashion is funny. My first customers, two customers I think were so important. And all of my customers, let me just say that, are so important. But the two, when you asked me about getting into the business,
mm-hmm.
so I remember I was friends with MC Light. And so she, one day, but I was friends with Milk and Giz.
They came, they got her.
That's
how I used
to
love Milk and Giz. Big top villain audio too. Shout out to the whole First Priority.
So that's how it started. They were one that came in the shop and they said they wanted me to make custom albums.
So did you help them with those outfits?
I Don't Care album cover. That was my first album cover.
All right. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
But she designed Milky Giz.
That was the first album cover.
She designed it. That's crazy.
And that was way back in the day.